So I'm Paul Olsen, and I'm at Columbia University. I'm at Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory, and I teach a course in dinosaurs and the history of life, which I've been doing since 1986. So it's been a journey, and I've enjoyed every moment of it, teaching primarily to undergraduates, but I gave a lot of lectures outside of that. So let me just tell you very briefly a little bit about myself. I was one of those kids that was mentioned earlier that knew everything about dinosaurs as a child and would tell anybody who I could grab the attention of much more than they ever wanted to know. But I kept that interest right through high school, and finally, when I was about 14, as Michael said, I found with my friend Tony many, many dinosaur footprints in New Jersey, and I worked to have that to a park. Since that time, I went to Yale University and did my undergraduate year. See, we have a new visitor, a new guest. I developed interest, very broad interest in geology, and now I work not only on dinosaurs, but on fossil fish. I work on how the Earth's climate records the movements of the planets. I work on mass extinctions. And at the end of this, I'd be happy to answer any general questions you might have. I also had projects that involve carbon sequestration, atmospheric carbon dioxide sequestration. This particular talk, I'll start by talking about what are dinosaurs, how did we figure out birds are dinosaurs, what was the origin of dinosaurs, what are the shocking new dinosaurs, and what killed the non-bird dinosaurs. It's since as Dr. Passau mentioned, dinosaurs are still alive in the form of birds. So first, what are dinosaurs? This is not that easy of a question, actually, when it gets right down to it. This is a very early dinosaur, a reconstruction of a very early dinosaur named Herrerasaurus. And as I go along, I'll mention where these names come from. Herrerasaurus is named after somebody named Victorio Herrera, who was an Argentinian goat herder who actually found these bones and reported them to a museum when they were subsequently collected. And Herrerasaurus is one of the earliest dinosaurs. It's quite small. Its hip was about the height of a human hip, not very big. So it's actually in the hip structure that the defining character of dinosaurs is. So here's a silhouette of a reconstruction of a skeleton of Herrerasaurus, and the hip has the key feature. Dinosaurs are characterized by upright motion in which the legs move in a vertical plane underneath their body, supporting them directly in that way, and they can run. That's an adaptation for running very fast. And as a consequence, evolution by natural selection has reduced the amount of bone that's on the inner side of the hip socket, because it doesn't have to have bone there because no forces are directed there. So the hip socket of Herrerasaurus, this is the hip, this is forward, this is the main hip bone, the ilium, this is the pubis, this is the ischium, and this is where the femur, the thigh bone, fits into the socket. And you can see there's no bone there. In a human being oriented with the hip the same way, that socket has a solid wall of bone in back of it, because our legs can move in many, many directions and do occasionally push sideways in there. So we need a bony cup to support it. In birds, they have this open hip socket exactly like in non-bird dinosaurs, because in fact they inherited it from their ancestors that are dinosaurs. So what I always like to do before I get into the weeds with these beasts, I like to talk a little bit about the geological time scale. So on the left, we have the entire history of the Earth from its formation about 4.6 billion years ago to the present. And then that's divided into these eons, the most recent of which is the Phanerozoic, which itself is divided into three eras, the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and the Cenozoic. And then that's expanded to these periods, which you can see on the right. Most of the history of life on Earth is occupied by times in which there were only bacteria. And it's not until about 700 million years ago that we see the first multicellular animals. And then that explodes in diversity at what's called the Cambrian explosion. Dinosaurs are limited to this little window of time in the Phanerozoic, which is this interval, the Mesozoic, the middle times, the age of dinosaurs. And that's divided into these three periods, Triassic, Jurassic, and Cretaceous, names that I'll repeat throughout the rest of this discussion. So this is the interval of time over which the non-bird dinosaurs existed. And I have to say non-bird dinosaurs because they lived after this with their descendants being birds, which actually evolved down here in the Jurassic, as we'll see in a moment. Humans, on the other hand, are restricted this little sliver of time right at the end here, 0.2 million years. And by the way, MA is an abbreviation for millions of years, which you'll also see again and again. So now we can turn our attention to dinosaurs. And how did we figure out that birds are, in fact, dinosaurs? They're direct living descendants of theropod, the meat-eating dinosaurs. Now, three characters that are especially important in how we know that birds are dinosaurs, and these are caricatures of these characters. Anybody know who these are?
Darwin.
Which one's Darwin?
On the left.
Anybody know any of the others? Okay, so the middle one. That's right. The right one is Huxley, Thomas Henry Huxley. How about the middle one? Well, it's a very flattering caricature of Sir Richard Owen. Sir Richard Owen named the Dinosauria in 1842. Darwin's important in this story because Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection basically consists of the idea that the environment filters the offsprings of organisms, and only those who fit the environment the best survive to leave offspring. And through enormous amounts of time, tiny changes in the frequency of, we would now say, in the frequency of genes, result in huge changes through time. And so his theory demanded that intermediates between all kinds of life existed. And his theory demanded that, but at the time in 1859, when The Origin of Species was published, there were no intermediates known. But the very first intermediate discovered turned out to be a dinosaur. And Thomas Henry Huxley, often known as Darwin's bulldog, showed that dinosaurs were intermediate in structure between reptiles, average reptiles like lizards or crocodilians, and birds. And this was the first missing link that was ever found. Many, many have been found since then, but it was absolutely key because Darwin regarded the absence of those intermediates as being one of the main obstacles to his theory. So what did Owen base this idea of dinosaurs upon in 1842? He based it upon fossil remains that were extraordinarily fragmentary. The oldest one discovered, found in 1822, consisted at that time mostly of teeth. Some bones were found later on, but not much. Those teeth resembled an iguana, and in 1824, this animal was actually named Iguanodon, which means iguana tooth. Megalosaurus, meaning giant lizard, was named in 1824 as well. And Hylaeosaurus, which means belonging to the forest lizard, was named in 1833. Despite the fragmentary nature of these remains, Owen was able to show that they belong to a great group of extinct animals, which he named the Dinosauria in 1842. But he didn't really know what they looked like because the remains were so scrappy. And when they were reconstructed for moving the Crystal Palace in London into a new location, there were these models made by Waterhouse Hawkins, Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins, of actual size, made out of cement and tiles and so forth. And two of these are shown here, Megalosaurus and Iguanodon. And they show one of the features that Owen thought were so important, the upright stance that he could actually tell from the pelvic bones of dinosaurs. But he thought they were like giant bear lizards. unlike anything we would recognize as a dinosaur today. As was mentioned by Michael, the Hadrosaurus falci, which was discovered in New Jersey and described in 1858, was the very first dinosaur skeleton ever to be mounted and showed people what dinosaurs, at least some dinosaurs, actually looked like. So it was recognized by those fossils that these were bipedal, that this was a bipedal animal. And this, by the way, is a stereopticon image, which was a Victorian device in the 1800s used to see 3D images. And that's why there are two of them. So this became incredibly important, as I mentioned, to Darwin, because these animals turn out to be intermediates between two great groups of organisms that today look utterly different, reptiles and birds. So that was published, that idea of the origin of species by means of natural selection was published in 1859, at which time there were no intermediates. But in 1861, 2 years later, the intermediates were discovered, first in the form of a very unusual bird, this rather roadkill-like specimen named Archaeopteryx, or first wing, and you can, or ancient wing, I should say, and it has, in addition to feathers, a very key bone called the furcula, or wishbone, which you'll see more of in a moment. But it also has this long bony tail. In the same year, a skeleton of a small dinosaur named Compsognathus, and actually I don't know what the name of that one is means, but it was about the size of a turkey and has these very, very long legs. Huxley immediately seized upon this skeleton and in 1868 wrote a paper titled On the Animals Which Are Most Nearly Intermediate Between Birds and the Reptiles. And in this, he says, but a single specimen obtained from those Solenops, where it's from, slates, to the accident of whose existence and usefulness in the art paleontology is so much indebted, affords a still nearer approximation to the missing link, first use of that term ever, between reptiles and birds. This is the singular reptile which has been described and named Compsognathus longippes by the late Andreas Wagner, and some of the more recondite ornithic affinities of which have been pointed out by Gegenbauer. Quite a mouthful. Notwithstanding its small size, it was not much more than 2 feet in length, this reptile, I think, must be placed among or close to the Dinosauria, but it is still more bird-like than any of the animals which are ordinarily included in that group. And by 1877, he did a reconstruction of Compsognathus in this very, very bird-like form and recognized that the dinosaur footprints, the footprints, reptile footprints thought to be birds in the early part of the 1800s, were in fact footprints of dinosaurs. Same paper, he recognized that. So he was the one who recognized Eubrontes giganteus was a dinosaur. In 1876, a year before that, this much more complete specimen of Archaeopteryx was found. Now, I mentioned before this bone in the chest of Archaeopteryx is called a furcula. It's not visible in this specimen being buried under rock. And this should be have been a clue, by the way, to problems which then followed this idea. So we recognize the wishbone as something you see in turkeys, but all birds have them. And they're a forked element that's equivalent to our clavicles, the two bones on either side of our neck that help support our shoulders. The problem that was developed is that although Thomas Henry Huxley's idea that dinosaurs were the group from which birds were derived, even though that gained popularity through the rest of the 19th century, in the earliest 20th century, when dinosaurs became much better known, a problem showed up that in regard to the furcula. You see, crocodile-like ancient reptiles and crocodiles today, as well as lizards and turtles and so forth, have a clavicle. That's that bone next to our neck. And birds have it fused in this form called the wishbone. This is a side view of the shoulder girdle where the arms attach. The humerus or upper arm bone fits right in here or over here in these two animals. But in dinosaurs in the early 1900s, no clavicles were known. So it was concluded that no, birds could have no relationship to dinosaurs, because once you lost a bone like this, it was argued, you could never re-evolve it. So if dinosaurs lack clavicles, then they could not have given rise to birds. Well, this turns out to be wrong. It was an accident, and then people should have recognized this looking at that newer, much more complete specimen of Archaeopteryx, because you couldn't see the furcula in that animal either. Well, this Huxley's idea that birds are derived from dinosaurs was reinvigorated by John Ostrom of Yale University. He was one of the people, by the way, that was involved with the preservation of Dinosaur State Park in Rocky Hill, Connecticut, which was mentioned earlier. John Ostrom was also my undergraduate advisor when I was at Yale, and he was also a graduate student at Columbia. What Ostrom recognized is looking at the bones of Archaeopteryx, here shown without feathers, and Velociraptor, an early Cretaceous theropod dinosaur, that you could match bone for bone every structure in this non-bird dinosaur with that of Archaeopteryx. And particularly this kind of dinosaur looked like it was a particularly active animal, and it had an extremely close correspondence in not just every bone, but the structure of every bone when you compare Velociraptor and Archaeopteryx. And yes, Archaeopteryx has a furcula, a wishbone, but it turns out, as recognized by John Ostrom, so did Velociraptor, so does a duck, and we now know, so did T-Rex. That's the wishbone of a Tyrannosaurus Rex. So Ostrom's idea were met with great skepticism, because by the 1970s, when he first started working on this, the idea that birds had evolved from dinosaurs was thoroughly discredited. So it was an uphill battle for him to convince other researchers that he was correct. One of the predictions that came out of this idea that birds are descended from dinosaurs is that very active dinosaurs, based on the structure, like Velociraptor, maybe they had feathers, not feathers for flight, but feathers for insulation. This also was a heretical idea and was met with great resistance. However, in 1996, this specimen was found. This is Sinosauropteryx, which basically means Chinese lizard wing. And Sinosauropteryx has very short arms, as you can see. It was not a flying animal, but it is covered from head to, head to leg with filamentous feathers. Filaments that could not have been used for flight, as in a bird wing, but rather were for insulation, completely validating Ostrom's argument. In fact, when Ostrom first saw the specimen in 1996, he's reported to have cried, because this was such a struggle for him and such a vindication. And now almost all researchers agree that non-avian dinosaurs had feathers, and we'll talk more about this in a little bit, and that birds are direct descendants of theropod dinosaurs. So when you look at Jurassic Park movies, the franchise, and you look at their dinosaurs, which are completely naked, this of course is Chris Pratt playing Owen Grady in Jurassic World in 2015. So they shouldn't have looked like this. They should have looked like that. And not only that, but this is supposed to be Velociraptor, and here's how big Velociraptor really was. So they really played the name. They liked the name Velociraptor, but in fact, Velociraptor would have been feathered. It would have been much smaller, and I think they still look pretty terrifying with feathers, to be perfectly frank. So what was the origin of these dinosaurs? Where did they come from? Where this is still a difficult area that we don't know much about. We much better understand where birds come from amongst dinosaurs than where dinosaurs come among reptiles. But nonetheless, there have been some recent big strides. So here are some earliest dinosaurs. We saw this one already, Herrerasaurus, and in this reconstruction we have some filaments, though certainly not enough. A much smaller one known as Eoraptor from the same rock formation, the Ishigalasa formation in Argentina. And Eoraptor means first stealer. And panphagia, which means one who eats everything based on the teeth, which look very omnivorous. And here is a cat for scale. All of these are at the same scale. So you can see all of these are quite small animals compared to where how we usually think about dinosaurs. Of course, they're descendant birds. Most of those are quite small too. But nonetheless, we've gotten this idea that dinosaurs are gigantic, and some of them truly were. But where did they come from? So we now have some ideas. One of my former students, Sterling Nesbitt, actually found in Madagascar and described some bones of a proto-dinosaur, which he named Conganaphon, or Conganaphon, I think that's how it should be pronounced. Conganaphon is tiny. You can see this is 10 millimeters, 1 centimeter here. So 2.5 centimeters in an inch. So this this bone, which is a femur, is only a little bit more than an inch long. But it has features that tell us that it's very closely related to dinosaurs in the way the femur is turned in like this. The reconstruction of this animal looks like this. Very, very tiny. And the idea basically is in the evolution of dinosaurs and their near relative, the flying reptiles known as pterosaurs, there was a miniaturization event where the common ancestor was extremely small. And that's the form in which many of the features that make dinosaurs, evolve. That the nature of the hip, its upright running motion, its full bipedality, and its covering of filamentous feathers. So here's a comparison of Conganaphon compared with Herrerasaurus. Very, very tiny. Now, when dinosaurs evolved, they didn't take over the Earth at once. They actually evolved very slowly. Instead, the landscape was dominated by various kinds of crocodile relatives called the Curatarsians, and these were competitors of dinosaurs. Some of them were much larger than dinosaurs at the time, and they had both herbivorous forms and carnivorous forms. There were semi-aquatic forms like the phytosaurs. There were fully terrestrial carnivores like Protopithecus. There were forms with sails like Arizonosaurus. There were bipedal forms like Ephigia, many of these forms, and they basically dominated the tropics. So even though there were dinosaurs at higher latitudes, this is the supercontinent of Pangaea, all the continents were united together in the Triassic, which split up later on. In the early part of the late Triassic, you had dinosaurs evolve in South America. Then they moved all the way across the tropics to the higher latitudes in North America and Greenland and Eurasia. And there's a link that Dr. Passau put into the page for this class that talks about this work based on work of Dennis Kent in Greenland and how maybe it was a lowering of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that allowed these dinosaurs to cross into the Northern Hemisphere. But even once they crossed in the tropics, they were virtually absent. The only forms around were very small dinosaurs. And instead, the major carnivore niche and herbivore niches were occupied by these crocodilian relatives. And only when they went extinct because of the eruptions of the giant volcanic province called the Central Atlantic Magmatic Province, did dinosaurs take over the world in the forms and grow much larger in the forms we recognize as familiar dinosaurs today. So now I'll talk about these rather shocking, relatively new discoveries, and some of them are very new, which we'll talk about. Now, many of you probably already know that dinosaurs are that contain birds, that birds are direct descendants of dinosaurs. And many of you probably know that birds and dinosaurs were feathered, but I want to show you the evidence for this. So I showed you one of these already, but what you may not know is that we actually know for real the color of these. So I taught this course on dinosaurs since 1986, and through most of that time, students would ask me, well, how do we know what how are dinosaurs colored? And I said, well, artists have great latitude in how they can show these reconstructions of dinosaurs. They basically, you can base it on nearest relatives like birds and like crocodiles. And of course, birds are all colors, so you can imagine dinosaurs could come in all colors as well. And that's all I could say about it. But when these dinosaurs in China were discovered with preserved feathers, it turned out we could learn the actual colors of dinosaurs. We can see them in color. So these newer fossils come from lake deposits, largely but not entirely in China. And these lake deposits produced this dinosaur I showed you earlier, Cynosauropteryx, along with many, many other dinosaurs that have been quite remarkable. I already told you about the filamentous feathers that are on Cynosauropteryx, but it turns out that the preservation of these feathers is so good that you can see the microscopic structure of the surface of the feathers. And there is the clue about the color, because it turns out that modern bird feathers, and it's actually true of scales on lizards as well, modern bird feathers have structures in the keratin, which is the same stuff that makes up our hair and fingernails, called melanosomes. And these melanosomes are different shapes depending on the color of the feather. So we can see those structures in, this is a fossil of a bird named Confucius ornus that's from these same lake deposits that Cynosauropteryx are from. And when you look at their feathers, you can see this different in the structure of the melanosomes. And since all birds that have certain colors have the same structures, and the structures are similar in lizard feathers, I mean, lizards don't have feathers, lizard scales, you can then infer that dinosaurs would have had those colors as well. So here's a reconstruction of Cynosauropteryx in living color. These are not make-believe. These are based on good, solid scientific inference. Sometimes we can see much more complicated color. This is from another deposit that's older in China. And you can see right off the bat that here's the skull, here's the neck, the backbone, here are forelegs and hind legs. You can see that there are feathers on the skeleton. And what can you see on the feathers? Anybody want to shout it out? What can you see on the feathers?
Looks like spots.
Spots and stripes. That's right. Well, the melanosomes on these feathers are beautifully preserved. They tell us that the crest up here was actually red, and these were white and black feathers, and the animal actually looked like this. This is not a bird. This is Anchiornis huxleyi. Anchiornis, that name means Huxley's near bird. As you can see, it looks very much like a bird, but it's not a bird. It's a non-avian dinosaur.
Would this be considered a precursor to current day birds?
It's not a precursor, but it's a near relative to the common ancestor of all birds.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
So we now, from the dinosaurs preserved in these kinds of deposits, actually have an idea of what their actual colors were. Now, most dinosaurs, we don't have that, but a growing number of them we do. So now we'll talk about the misnamed Oviraptor. This is a very famous dinosaur. When I first started teaching about these dinosaurs in 1986, I used a book about dinosaurs by David Norman. And in that was this picture of a Protoceratops from Mongolia attacking an Oviraptor. Protoceratops means first horn face, and Oviraptor means what? What does Oviraptor mean?
Egg thief.
Egg thief. That's exactly what Oviraptor means. And it was found in association with eggs. The eggs were thought to be those of a Protoceratops. So it was reasoned, this was all the way back in 1924, by Henry Fairfield Osborne, by the way, who was the president of the American Museum of Natural History, and sent Roy Chapman F. Andrews out to the Gobi Desert and found Oviraptor instead of the origin of humans. But in any case, it was named Oviraptor because it was thought surely this animal was stealing these eggs. Well, that turns out to be wrong. And in the 1990s, a joint Mongolian and American Museum expeditions discovered this skeleton in the field, where you can see a big claw of a hand here and some other bones. And when that was prepared, you could see hind feet here. It's only a fragmentary specimen. because of weathering, not because it was perfect when it was fossilized. These are hind feet here. These are forelegs, the arms, and under it is a rosette of eggs. Well, those aren't Protoceratops eggs. Those are Oviraptor eggs. And we actually know they're Oviraptor eggs because some of them have skeletons of embryonic Oviraptor in them. So there's zero doubt that this animal is brooding its eggs and was brooding its eggs when it was preserved. I believe it was in a burrow that collapsed when that happened, but never mind. It was buried with its eggs on its nest. So it was reconstructed like this, but it wasn't known in 1995 that all birds had feathers. And this was shown for Oviraptor to have feathers by the discovery of a relative in these Chinese lake deposits named Caudipteryx. And Caudipteryx means tail feathers. And you can see it has on its tail the spray of feathers and its arm short feathers and over its body filaments. So this is how its close relative Oviraptor should be reconstructed, with a set of Oviraptor parents taking care of the eggs. So Oviraptor was not an egg thief. It was taking care of its eggs. And it turns out Protoceratops looks like it may have had leathery eggs. And even though Protoceratops was the most common dinosaur in those deposits, we didn't find the eggs, found those of Oviraptor instead, because the eggs of Protoceratops were leathery and didn't preserve with the shell. So amongst these same lake deposits that we got Caudipteryx from, we have what look like biplane dinosaurs. Well, we know birds have wings. They fly with their arms, their feathers on the arms, the feathers act as airfoils. Together, the arms are airfoils with all those feathers on them. And that's the mechanism by which birds gain lift to fly. And it came as quite a shock when it was realized that some of the non-avian dinosaurs with feathers had not two wings, but four. This is an example of pedipenna, which means a foot feather. And pedipenna has four wings. And this is a reconstruction of pedipenna, like a biplane. And there are other dinosaurs with this structure. And it turns out even Archaeopteryx has smaller flight feathers on its hind limbs, but it has some. And this may have been a stage in the evolution of modern bird flight when there were actually four wings, not just two. And one of the spectacular discoveries of dinosaurs from China are three-dimensional dinosaurs. And I think my favorite is this one named Soundly Sleeping Dinosaur Dragon, or Mi Long. Long means dragon in Chinese. Means soundly sleeping. And here's that specimen that's 2 centimeters, so it's a little bit less than an inch. So you can see it's a very small dinosaur. This is a truodontid dinosaur. We know from other examples of truodontids from the same formation, which is named the Yishan in China, that that these truodontids were feathered. But you can see this is not reconstructed. This is just with the rock removed from the skeleton, that the animal was buried again, probably in a burrow, with its tail curled around it and it with its head tucked in its arm, sleeping exactly like a modern bird. So we see that these dinosaurs, all of them, had feathers in one way or another and had behavioral characteristics, including parental care and even the way they sleep, which they share with modern birds, and which in fact modern birds inherited from their non-avian dinosaur ancestors. There are not just small dinosaurs in these deposits, so there are large ones as well, including a feathered tyrannosaur. Actually, there are several feathered tyrannosaurs, but the largest one is named Eutyrannus, which means the beautiful feathered tyrant. As you can see, this is several meters long. This is one skeleton, this is another skeleton. And here's a close-up of just one of those skeletons. It's a complete skeleton, as you can see. However, when you look closely at this skeleton, for example, on its tail, what do you see? Those are the tail bones, and what's around them? What's all this?
Are those more filaments?
Those are more filaments. So this rather large dinosaur, Eutyrannus, was completely covered in filaments. This has made people rethink the greatest of all tyrannosaurs, who is? Yeah, it's T-Rex. So Tyrannosaurus Rex, the tyrant lizard, the king, is thought to also have had some feathers. Now, most of its body was not covered with feathers. We know that because there are extensive areas of the body of Tyrannosaurus preserved as skin impressions, and it has scales over most of its body. But it didn't need feathers for insulation because it was so big. It had trouble dumping heat. So it probably just had feathers for show. In this case, shown bright red. The American Museum model that's on exhibition now has it just as this sort of mullet on T-Rex. I like the other reconstruction better. But even though as an adult, it may have been mostly scaled and naked and just had a little bit of these filaments left because it was so huge, its young certainly were feathered, which it inherited from its ancestors, which were fully feathered like Eutyrannus. And the little ones had it because they need this covering of insulation. So these dinosaurs, Tyrannosaurus Rex, of course, was a giant. A lot of these other dinosaurs were quite small, like Pedipenna, or like Anchiornis huxleyi, or like Sinoceropteryx. But dinosaurs, as it turns out, were the largest living animals ever on Earth, even exceeding the size of the blue whale. And one of them is on exhibit, and that's Patagotitan, named after Patagonia, the Patagonian Titan. This was excavated. It was discovered by a farmer, but it was excavated by another student that I was on his committee, Diego Paul, and he's shown here lying next to the thigh bone, the femur of this animal in 2015. Now, this animal is truly gigantic. And because of the affiliation that Diego Paul had with the American Museum of Natural History, that's where his office was when he was a student at Columbia, just before this, he wanted to get a skeleton. The American Museum wanted a skeleton of this on exhibit. But these bones are quite fragile despite their size, and they're enormously heavy. So instead of trying to ship the bones to North America and mount the skeleton, which by the way isn't done anymore because it damages the bones tremendously, they were 3D modeled, 3D printed, cast, and reconstructed in fiberglass. An amazing thing, the whole process from discovery to mounting it took 1 year. Usually it took a decade to go from discovery to a mounted skeleton. It took 1 year. And here's
you can see a video about that.
Right here.
We went down to Argentina.
Working.
And we 3D scanned all the bones in the field and in the lab. We had the whole skeleton completely digitized in 4 weeks. We took the data and then we carved the bones out of slabs of foam with our 5-axis milling machine. We molded all the elements once they're carved up, and then we have a complete copy of the skeleton. And from there, we can cast all the elements out of fiberglass. And then the cast gets mounted.
So the skeleton was put together, but then it was cast in New York and assembled. And here is a high speed animation of it being assembled in the American Museum of Natural History. We'll be right back. So that is how we got the mounted skeleton at the American Museum of Natural History. Now, this animal, from tip of the tail to the front of the snout, is about 122 feet long, and a blue whale is about 94 feet long. Now, blue whales are much heavier, but they're in the water. And Patagotitan is larger in length than the blue whale. So now let's go the other end of the spectrum to smaller dinosaurs, but really, really weird ones. Really, really weird ones. These are Yiqui and Anabopteryx. These are dinosaurs who developed flight, but not of the bird kind, and did not use their feathers for flight. Yiqui is a very, very small dinosaur. And it has on its arms an extra bone, a very strange extra bone, and a membrane on the wing. And here's a reconstruction. Yiqui means strange wing, and indeed it is a strange wing. This dinosaur, it's a real dinosaur, had a bat-like wing, a membrane wing, with an extra bone off the wrist to help support it. It had no bird-like feathers. It had instead the filaments like we saw in Sinosauropteryx. So bird wings have lift because of the flight feathers, not because of a membrane. Pterosaur wings, another group of flying reptiles very closely related to dinosaurs, but not dinosaurs, their wing was made out of filaments that were joined into a membrane, but the wing of Yiqui seems to be a completely new invention. There are several of these kinds of dinosaurs. Another one discovered very recently is Anabopteryx, which means both wing. In other words, like if you're ambidextrous, you have both hands, and it has a membrane similar to that of Yiqui. And here's a lovely little video that was produced by the people who described this dinosaur, with an allusion to Harry Potter. Again, only filaments, no flight feathers, and that extra bone in the wrist. So that is a seriously weird set of small dinosaurs. Now, going at the other end of the scale again to the gigantic side, we have this beast, Deinochirus. It's an ostrich mimic gone seriously big. So this dinosaur was discovered by the Polish-Mongolian expeditions in the 1970s, but only the arms were found. And this is a Mongolian paleontologist named I can never pronounce his name right, Altarangel Pearl, and Dr. Pearl participated in the discovery of this beast, and it was named Deinochirus, which means terrible. It actually means terrible hand, and you can see why it was called that, because of these enormous claws on the hand. As it turns out, it's a vegetarian, but anyway, it had those claws. Now, what kind of animal this was a mystery for a long time. However, it shares with a group of dinosaurs called the Ornithomimids, this particularly one called Gallimimus, famous in Jurassic Park again, the structure of these bones in the hand, the metacarpals. And they're virtually identical in Dinochirus and Gallimimus, so it was reason that perhaps Dinochirus was a scaled up version of Gallimimus itself, which means, by the way, chicken mimic. And it's an ornithomimid or bird mimic. And you can see the similarities in the proportions between an ostrich and an ornithomimid like Gallimimus. So it's thought maybe this was a scaled up version of that, but no more complete remains of Dinochirus were found until 2014, when two pretty darn good skeletons were found in Mongolia, and they proved that, in fact, it was an ornithomimid, but a seriously weird ornithomimid, truly gigantic, as you can see by a human ear, a skull without teeth and rather duck-like in structure. So it certainly was an herbivore. So here's a reconstruction. Very reasonable one. We know this group has feathers. They've been found on other ornithomimids, even ones from North America. And so this is a very reasonable illustration of what these animals look like. Giant herbivores with this very strange back. Now, this hasn't made that back very fleshy, maybe holding fat, but most workers think it was probably a thinner structure. More like another beast with a sail, that was truly gigantic. Anybody want to guess what the next animal I'm going to show you is? Even bigger than this? The largest carnivore ever known?
Probably Spinosaurus.
Spinosaurus. But it's much weirder than you think. So here's a clip. Well, first, let me back off a little bit and mention that in my teaching, I would always say, you know, all these things that look kind of like dinosaurs, like plesiosaurs or ichthyosaurs, those are aquatic reptiles, but they're not dinosaurs. And I would say there are no dinosaurs that we know of at all that are aquatic, except for some modern birds, like penguins that are aquatic, and ducks, and loons, but no non-avian dinosaur was known to be aquatic. That is now wrong. But here's the standard view of Spinosaurus as seen in Jurassic Park 3. Now this volume's a little low, so you might have to boost your volume.
What?
I loaned it to Nash. He must have had it when he...
Perfectly reasonable reconstruction for its time. In fact, Spinosaurus was first found in Egypt in 1915 and described by a researcher named Stormer, and it was known from incomplete remains, mostly bones off the back, and this is how Stormer reconstructed a Spinosaurus. At that time, they didn't even know what the skull was shaped like, except they had a lower jaw, but they didn't have the top of it. So this was the reconstruction of Spinosaurus. By the early 2000s and 2013, there were much more complete remains of Spinosaurus, and it could be reconstructed like this. And that's where the reconstruction you saw in Jurassic Park 3 came from. However, and it was clearly larger than T-Rex or any other carnivore, much larger, with a very crocodile-like head. And some researchers started reasoning at that time that maybe this animal was a fish eater, because a close relative in the UK named Baryonyx was actually found with fish in its gut. Same kind of skull, very similar skull, but without the sail. Then very recently, Nizar Ibrahim who's a professor at University of Detroit. His parents are of Moroccan descent, and he made a discovery in Morocco of much more complete remains of Spinosaurus. These are Cretaceous in age. And what he was able to show is it has shorter legs relative to the body that anybody thought, and a big, big tail of the type that you'd have if you were to what?
Swim.
Swim. So this forced a complete rethinking of the ecology of Spinosaurus, and it is now recognized almost certainly, not everybody agrees with this, but I certainly don't understand why the tail would be like this otherwise, certainly a swimmer. And so it's reconstructed like this. And now I have a little video clip of showing you a Spinosaurus in motion from National Geographic. Ibrahim was funded by National Geographic to make these, and made these discoveries with those grants.
Banagpex?
Pardon me?
Does that mean it was kind of like an amphibian, like on land and in water?
It certainly had to lay its eggs on land, that's for sure. But it looks like it was spent a lot of its life swimming and was an aquatic predator. So those are some of the weird new discoveries. I'm going to finish up by talking about what killed the non-bird dinosaurs. So most of you know the story. What killed the non-bird dinosaurs?
Impact,
an asteroid impact 66 million years ago. And this was discovered by a wonderful hypothesis based on an anomaly. So this is a great story about how science can progress. So this guy here, Walter Alvarez, was a geophysicist who was actually at Lamont for a while, before moving to University of California, Berkeley. But he worked on the magnetization that's preserved within rocks. And he knew a lot about the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary in Italy, where he worked, and he'd worked on the magnetization of these rocks. And through discussions with his father, they decided to start a project to try to measure the amount of time over which the extinctions at the end of the Cretaceous took place. So there are little fossils in these limestones called foraminifera, the single-celled organisms, and they change completely right over this line of dark clay. And so most of them are absent up here. Most of the different species are absent up here, and down here there are many, many species. And so this was recognized as the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary. And his father was a Nobel laureate physicist, Louis Alvarez. And together with Frank Acero and Helen Michael, they decided to use an element, a stable element, it's not radioactive, called iridium. It's a platinum group element. It's actually it's about 10% of most platinum rings and jewelry is actually iridium. And it's very, very rare in the Earth's crust. And they decided to use it because it's almost inert. And so once it gets into a setting, it doesn't go away. Now they recognize that iridium is very, very rare in the Earth's crust, even though it's relatively common in material outside the Earth in the solar system, like in extraterrestrial dust or in meteors or comets, because they retain the original ratios of the various elements that form the solar system. But in Earth, when the Earth formed, it underwent what's called the iron catastrophe, and iridium went to the core of the Earth, leaving the crust depleted in iridium. So they reasoned they could use iridium as a way to measure time, assuming that it was arriving on Earth at a relatively constant rate from interplanetary dust. And then they measured it at this site in Gubbio where Walter had worked before, and they found this huge increase of several orders of magnitude increase in the concentration of iridium exactly at that layer. Now, one way to explain this was could be that the accumulation of other materials just turned off and all you had was the accumulation of extraterrestrial dust. But that wouldn't work because Walter's original work on the section showed that most of this interval was deposited in 500,000 years. And if you calculated the amount of iridium that it would have to accumulate to make this layer, it would have to arrive at business as usual rate in 20 million years. And they concluded this was wrong. Their assumptions about iridium coming in at a constant rate were wrong. And the easiest way to explain this was an asteroid hit the Earth enriched in iridium 66 million years ago, wiping out the dinosaurs and many other forms of life on Earth. This was a brilliant deduction. So they had an observation which was anomalous with respect to their leading hypothesis for what they were trying to do in the first place. So they abandoned that line of reasoning and instead explained the iridium anomaly with a completely novel hypothesis of a giant asteroid impact. This was in 1980. So the scenario they proposed was the Earth was hit with a big rock. That rock vaporized completely. That may be on the order of 10 to 15 kilometers in diameter, as big as Mount Everest. And when it vaporized, it put dust into the above the atmosphere, which circled the Earth, shutting off sunlight and resulting in a collapse of the food chain in which all large animals on the planet died. Everything larger than a dog died, went extinct because of a lack of food, basically. And it was also very, very cold. And then afterwards, the atmosphere would clear and life would come back to normal. Now, this hypothesis made some predictions that they didn't know the answers to back in 1980. For example, it made a prediction that there would be shock quartz, a product of a high speed, ultra high shock pressure effects that was found in the clay layer. It made the prediction that there would be a vaporized rock that might rain down as glass balls, little spherules, and that was shown to be correct. And then eventually the crater was discovered. It actually had been found in 1981, but nobody knew it. It was found by some oil geologists, and it wasn't realized that Chicxulub in Mexico was the site until 1990s, but there it was. There was the actual impact structure. We know where it is. And there are other predictions it makes as well, like giant tsunamis. Here we have a plesiosaur, not a dinosaur, being carried away by a giant wave that would have rolled over the landscape. So back in the 1990s, when I was teaching my course, there were some documentaries on the KT boundary and about Chicxulub, and I put two of them together. I made a mashup video showing the events at this time. And I'll show you that now. And Peter Domenical, another professor who was at Columbia, he's moved to Woods Hole, put in the music. It was a beautiful day in the Cretaceous. I guess it was in the 2000s I put this together. But in space, flash of light. That's a T-Rex there. A baby T-Rex is around. A dead T-Rex. Flash of light. Shockwave traveling at the speed of sound through rock arrives thousands of kilometers away. Huge earthquake. Immense magnitude. Shockwave blows away everything. Within minutes, a fireball arrives with the descent of a rain of balls of glass. mashup was made in the early 2000s. Amazingly, a site was described in 2019 that records the minutes around the impact. This is a site called TANIS, and this is the location in North Dakota. And it's excavated by a very unconventional team of scientists, which we can talk about later. But the layers there actually preserve a giant inland sea tsunami that rolled over the landscape, killing dinosaurs and fish, followed by the rain of glass and then the dust from the iridium anomaly. Here's a small ball of glass that arrived and made a little dent in the sediments in this deposit. And here are spherules from that layer. Now, there's way more than this at this site. There are hundreds of complete fish. We're looking at a paddlefish here. They're alive today, paddlefish. This is a different species, an extinct species. And this is a sturgeon. They're alive today. Their gills are choked with the glass spherules. So from this deposit, the authors were able to deduce the following. 66 million years ago, an asteroid strikes in Chicxulub, launching rock and dust into the atmosphere and causing tsunami-like waves. The shock wave travels 2,000 miles to North Dakota, to where the Hell Creek Formation, which contains T-Rex and Triceratops, by the way, in North Dakota. The seismic waves hit roughly 10 minutes after the impact, creating in the inland sea a 30-foot wave. Ballistic glass beads traveling with ballistic trajectories from the impact site land within 45 minutes of the impact. So here's the Earth at that time. The continents had not completely reached their present condition. Here's the inland sea. The impact was here in what's now Mexico. And that site called TANIS is up here in North Dakota. And so preserved in this deposit are the catastrophic events that occurred minutes after the impact. And so that scenario that I showed you, developed by scientific deduction, now tested by empirical evidence, was correct. Not only are those events plausible, they happened. And here's a reconstruction from 2019 of that site at the moment the seismic waves were hitting the inland sea, with a drowning Triceratops and various fish about to get about to die themselves from the infalling glass. And there's the light from the fireball that's on its way. So non-avian dinosaurs are extinct. We have an amazing record of the events around their extinction, but happily they're not completely extinct. And every time you see a flock of birds, you're seeing the survivors. And of course, birds are still more diverse than dinosaurs. There are about 10,000 species of birds and about 4,000 species of dinosaurs. So in a very real way, we're still in the age of dinosaurs. And I'll be happy to take any questions now.
Thank you very much, Paul. It was great. Okay, unmute yourselves, please, and start asking questions.
Paul, I have a question for you.
Sure.
In a textbook that we used to work with at my school, it says some scientists have suggested that widespread volcanism in India, combined with severe greenhouse gas conditions at the end of the Cretaceous, caused significant stress that reduced the population size of many species prior to the Yucatan Peninsula meteor impact. Is that something that's consistent with what you've seen?
About 50%. So there is no doubt, absolutely no doubt, zero, that there were gigantic lava flow eruptions that were occurring in India starting before the impact occurred. Now, you notice that that quote did not say the impact didn't occur. It said it did
occur. Right.
So we also know that similar outpourings of lava of the exact same kind at the end of the Permian and end of the Triassic caused mass extinctions. So they seem to be, they're temporally associated with the extinction. One possible mechanism for that extinction is a massive increase in carbon dioxide from the eruption of the lava flows. And for, we don't have it for the, as well for the end of the Cretaceous, but we do for the end Triassic. We know that CO2 doubled to tripled during the time those lavas erupted. In fact, some of the unerupted lava, the magma, is the Palisades Sill. And we know those lava flows, just like the ones in India, started before the extinctions. And we know that CO2 doubled to tripled. Now, based on modeling of our future, a doubling of CO2 would produce about a 3 to 4 degree increase in global temperatures on average. And so if it quadrupled, it would be a 6 to 8 degree increase in temperature. There is some evidence that at the KT boundary, CO2 also tripled, but it's scant evidence, and it's not enough to be absolutely certain. However, the trouble is that the impact itself, we know, liberated a huge amount of CO2. How do we know that? Because the rocks it hit were limestone, and when limestone's heated and vaporized, anybody know what happens?
Forms cement.
And what happens? There's something that's released when that cement's formed.
Carbon dioxide.
Exactly. There's no way that didn't happen at the KT boundary as a result of that impact. So there are two sources of CO2, one from the impact, one from that. However, this is brand new work. I didn't talk about it because it would take up too much time. I had it in the original version, cut out 20 slides. I only have 100 slides in this presentation. Had 130. And I took that discussion out, but basically,
get you next year, Paul.
Right. Well, what we know, remember, dinosaurs are insulated, right? They have feathers, and this would be true of small dinosaurs and large dinosaurs. What else is produced other than carbon dioxide by giant volcanic eruptions or any volcanic eruptions?
Sulfur.
In what form? Comes out as sulfur dioxide. When that goes into the atmosphere, it reacts with water to make what?
Sulfuric acid.
The sulfuric acid has exactly the opposite effect of the carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide acts as it is a greenhouse gas, and it acts to absorb long wave radiation from Earth. That's basically heat coming from sunlight hitting the Earth, and then re-radiates that heat back towards Earth. So the more carbon dioxide you have, the warmer it gets. We all know this story, right? So, and there's no question about the physics, zero. Sulfur dioxide and sulfuric acid, the sulfuric acid forms these highly reflective droplets in the upper atmosphere, which produces increased albedo, reflects the light back, and cools the Earth. However, the carbon dioxide takes about 10,000 years for most of it to come out of the atmosphere, and for it to return to background level takes about 400,000 years. The sulfur dioxide, however, lasts for 5 years, and then it's gone. So we know this from observation of modern eruptions. The amount of sulfur put into the atmosphere by these eruptions, if they were concentrated in short time, would be enough to freeze the tropics for a few years. And that's what we think is the killing mechanism for the end Triassic extinction. And who survived?
The mammals.
Warm-blooded.
And?
Birds.
Birds.
Well, dinosaurs, right? The end Triassic extinction. I'm talking about, not the end Cretaceous. That's who, right? But birds weren't around at the end of the Triassic. But their relatives were, the non-avian dinosaurs, and they also were insulated. So everything big that was insulated survived the end Triassic extinction. And everything that was big that was not insulated, all those crocodile relatives I told you, like phytosaurs that were big, all non-insulated large land animals went extinct. And all large insulated animals survived, and all small insulated animals survived. So pterosaurs, the flying dinosaur relatives, they survived. Dinosaurs survived. Mammals survived. And anything that could burrow survived. So the only relatives of crocodiles that survived were their ancestors, the Protosuchians and the Sphenosuchians. And they were all this big. And they could burrow. We know they burrow. We find them in burrows. So they survived. Turtle survived. Lizard survived. Frog survived. Salamander survived. All things that can survive in burrows, and larger things, if they weren't insulated, were wiped out. Now, is that consistent with an increase in heat or cold?
Cold.
Cold.
Cold. The same pattern seems to be true for the end Permian, where all the large non-insulated animals went extinct. And burrowers and insulated animals like mammal relatives survived, and only the small reptiles survived that could burrow. KT was different. What's different about the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary? Because also, by the way, at that impact site was also gypsum, and that was vaporized. Yes. And what do you get when you vaporize gypsum?
SO2.
Sulfates.
You get sulfate, you get blastoparis, and you also get a huge amount of sulfur dioxide ending up in the atmosphere, causing the decrease in temperature. But what else is happening at the KT boundary that's different than what happened at those other two times? Something really different.
Tsunami. Hot glass.
What was the main argument for the killing mechanism that the Alvarez group came up with? Was it cold?
Climatic winter?
It was an impact winter, but what about the winter was bad?
No food. Different.
Why was there no food?
No sunlight.
There was no sunlight. That's the difference. And without the food, insulated or not, if you're large, you're out of luck. And so that was the filter that wiped out the non-avian dinosaurs. Years of darkness, no food. Small things could survive on detritus, garbage, and dead dinosaurs. There were a lot of dead dinosaurs around for little things to eat. Years worth of carcasses. So everything small or detritivores survived. Well, actually, not everything. Actually, birds were pretty bad, hard hit too, but they obviously survived. And so mammals were also hard hit, but they also survived. Again, the insulated ones got through, but you also had to be small. That was the difference between those two extinctions and the KT boundary. Now, one other thing, by the way, the CO2 does is it acidifies the oceans. And that was a factor for the CO2. So global warming may not have had that much of an effect on extinctions on land, but in the ocean, the CO2 raising the acidity was disastrous for organisms with shells. And that was true for the KT, and it was true for all those two other extinctions as well.
How long do we think that winter lasted?
2 to 6 years.
Okay.
With the minus 26 degrees C temperatures globally.
Oh.
And 95% reduction in sunlight.
Mm.
That's a model. That's based on models. Been done a couple times now. Come up with basically the same results.
Sounds like Texas.
Mm. I forgot to mention, there was just a publication just within the last couple of weeks of a study of a mouse species, a mouse species endemic to Mount Pinatubo. What happened to Mount Pinatubo in 1993?
Large volcanic eruption.
Right. A really big volcanic eruption.
Cooled the air for at least a year.
Right. Actually cooled it for 3 years, dropped it down about 0.4 degrees. Well, how habitable do you think Pinatubo was during the eruption?
Not very. So
there's a species of mouse which only lives on Mount Pinatubo. So you could imagine that the ecologists and biologists there were extremely worried that this mouse, only living on Mount Pinatubo, would be wiped out. Well, guess what? It survived. Guess where?
Underground.
Underground in burrows. Not only did it survive, but when it came back, it actually replaced other species that were much more widespread that were living on that mountain as well. So that model works pretty good.
Thank you, sir.
Additional questions?
We had a quick question.
Sure.
How do they calculate how fast dinosaurs move?
Badly. So there are a couple different ways. Most of the ways that involve inferences from the structure of the skeleton are very iffy. They're like that story about the engineers concluding that a bumblebee couldn't fly. Animals can do a lot of things that if you work on simple engineering principles wouldn't seem to be plausible, because we don't understand either the anatomy or the physics enough to be able to predict what they can actually do. There's another way of measuring, though, and that's using footprints. So the footprints show us that some dinosaurs could run very fast, 40 kilometers an hour, something like that. But footprints of very fast animals are very rare, because animals don't spend most of their time running. Even those who can run very fast don't spend most of their time running. So the probability, if you have some random discovery of dinosaur footprints, of catching the one who happens to be running at its maximum speed is like close to zero. That doesn't mean you couldn't find it. It's just very unlikely you would find it. So we do know from the footprints that some of the dinosaurs could run very fast. We also know from the footprints that most of the footprints are of walking dinosaurs. Hardly surprising. We also know, looking at the structure of some dinosaurs, that when you look, say, at Gallimimus, for example, or Struthiomimus, any of the ornithomimids except for the gigantic one like Deinocheirus, that their limbs have proportions that are only seen in very fast-running birds. But that doesn't mean we're right about that, right? But the footprints are a much more direct measure of that. I personally, I think the whole reason, well, this is another theory that isn't published yet, so don't run out and send it off to Science magazine. The reason the adaptive significance of enlarged feathers of the bird type on the arms of non-flying dinosaurs, why would they have that? Why would they have these short feathers, but of a bird type on the arm? Well, it turns out that ostriches have rather long wing feathers as well, but they don't fly. What they do is run very, very fast. And when they run, they're big. They're big animals. When they run, they're running at, say, 45 miles an hour. When they make a hard turn, what's a plausible outcome of that hard turn? Yeah, they turn over, right? They flip, right? Well, how do you think they manage that? Well, if they're making a right-hand turn, they stick out their right arm, which has got these long feathers on it. And what does that do?
That's some stability.
It slows them down, right, on that side. So when they turn, their center of mass isn't flipping to the other side. Instead, they're being slowed down on exactly the right way to make that turn. And so you'll see them as they're running along, sticking their arms out in various ways to do these different maneuvers. That's what I think those feathers evolved for. So they were of adaptive significance, even when they started increasing in area from the little filaments. They're immediately of adaptive significance, because anything that would increase the surface area of your arm would slow you down in that way. And all of the animals, by the way, all of the dinosaurs from those lake deposits that have those arm feathers have really long legs.
Very cool.
Paul, we have a question from Chris. You want to ask it?
Yes. Chris.
Question is whether there's any evidence of different shades between male and female.
That we don't know yet. We don't have enough of them. It's reasonable, because most bird species have different color, male and female. But not all, but most do. And that's also true of different lizard species. There tend to be differences among males and females. So, I mean, it helps. Actually, it's not very easy to tell a male bird from a female bird without those color differences. And so that they mean a lot to the birds.
Thank you very much.
I was curious about something, actually.
So Christiana is going to edit this and put it up on the
Very good.
Lake Class website. We'll let you all know when it's up.
All right. A pleasure, folks. Thanks.